Back to the second session. I hope you had a nice coffee break. So the second session will be four talks from Microsoft Research. And the first talk is Antonio Criminisi talking about how machine learning can solve medical imaging.
Thank you very much, Sebastian, for inviting me to talk today. And thank you, everybody, for coming to this talk. So I'm glad there was a coffee break between the previous session and this, because I think this session is going to look and feel quite different. So I'll start with some gentle introduction into medical imaging. And my work here is more to do with the application of efficient types of machine learning for the automatic analysis of medical images, especially to do with automatic segmentation of healthy anatomy, but also anomalies such as tumors or aneurysms and these sort of things, which is, of course, of great use in clinical practice. And so my research is always driven by this basic question: is what I'm doing useful in practice, or is it not? And the theory and the algorithms, they come afterwards. So medical images are used in Addenbrooke's and in many other hospitals in the Western world, of course. They get acquired with very expensive hardware. They get used, and the use is also very expensive because they are highly paid individuals looking at these images. And then they get archived. And the archiving, especially in the UK, lasts forever. You have to archive those images indefinitely. And that, of course, is also very expensive. The clinical use is interesting because these images can be used mostly for two areas. One is diagnosis and one is treatment. And in diagnosis, most of the work is to do with just eyeballing, which is surprisingly incredibly effective, accurate and efficient. So trained individuals, they just look at an image like the one at the top there and say, this is a glioma or glioblastoma brain tumor. And most of the time, they're right. Of course, there are some edge cases, like diagnosing things like malaria or other diseases that might be very rare could be a lot more difficult. And that's where perhaps it would be useful to have some sort of more quantitative measuring tools. But I believe that automatic machine learning-based measuring quantitative tools can be especially effective in the area of treatment. When you have things like two what's called longitudinal studies, two different time point images, images of the same patient taken at two different stages. You can see that there is a tiny tumor here which has grown into a much bigger tumor in the liver here. Then being able to say exactly how much the tumor has grown compared to the previous visit, exactly tracking the progression of the disease, especially as a function of perhaps two different types of treatments, is invaluable. And right now, doctors do not have any good tools for being able to do this quantitative evaluation. And so even in the treatment area, they just look at things, eyeball, and say, oh, I estimate the tumor is grown by 200%, or this sort of very not rigorous type of evaluation. So I've got a small team here in Cambridge that now we're looking at not only doing more research in this area, but also turning this into a product that can be sold to clinical experts in the field and can have a real impact on how healthcare is delivered, at least in this particular sector of radiology. I'm going to go through all these points relatively quickly because we don't have the whole day, of course. I'm going to touch base on a little bit of the science, in particular trying to compare one of our favorite tools, which is random forests, with another one of our favorite tools, more recent one, which is convolutional neural networks, and look at similarities and differences. I'm also going to show a couple of demos so that I can convince you that these things work in practice on complex and dimensional medical images. And then I'm going to conclude. Right, so of course, we are all aware of deep convolutional neural networks and how they have revolutionized the field of computer vision and are revolutionizing also the field of medical imaging, unsurprisingly. But also in this lab in particular, we've done a lot of work on random forests, and they also found very good applications such as Kinect and medical images, work that we've done ourselves. And there are some conceptions and misconceptions, perhaps. Some of them are founded, some of them might not be so founded. One of them, that these two worlds are extremely different from one another. Other things, like convolutional neural networks, are incredibly accurate, and indeed they are. And decision forests are also accurate, but maybe not quite as accurate as convolutional neural networks. Decision forests might be easier to train, and they don't require GPUs, while convolutional neural networks, they require big farms of GPUs and all these sort of things. But are the two models really so different from one another? This is what myself and my team have been spending a lot of time looking into. And we reinvented something that then we discovered was known since the 1990s, which is the fact that actually you can map any decision tree into a two-layer perception. And so this is really interesting. And the construction of how you can do the mapping is quite straightforward. Let's think of a decision tree as a function, a nonlinear function, which maps a multidimensional input V into a unique identifier, which is an identifier of the leaf that is reached by that tree, by applying that tree. So what we can do is we can first of all, take all the split nodes, the internal nodes, and create a hidden layer in the middle. Here at the input, we have just the different features of the input vector, v. And here we have all the nodes, that are the corresponding to the split nodes in the tree. And this is a fully connected, projection matrix, and there are some nonlinearities here. And these, bold face edges, they're just, hyperplanes, which effectively represents columns or rows of this projection matrix, depending on how you which way you represent it. And of course, there are non-linearities as well. We can use the usual sigmoid or rectified linear units there. And then, of course, the particular structure of the tree can be different. You can have more branches here or here. It's not necessarily balanced. And that is represented by a sparse projection matrix on the second layer, where we have here as the final nodes here that represent one-to-one the leaves of the tree. And this sparse connection here represents the connections that you have here. Effectively, it's a way of representing AND operations. And to represent the fact that you have different branches have got different depths, you have different biases attached to these final units. And this is well known, though, well, it is known, perhaps not very commonly known. And we built on this, and here is a little simulation that shows how when you input random numbers here, you always get to a leaf node. And actually, in this case, we have non-binary values because you can very easily change the slant of the sigmoid. And so effectively, that represents soft trees almost for free, practically. The fact that we have functional equivalence between these two doesn't necessarily mean that we have computational equivalence. And in fact, this can be seen by the fact that when a data point traverses a tree, it only follows one path if it is a hard tree. And therefore, only computation attached to the split nodes 2, 5, and 10 needs to be computed. Everything else runs no computation at all. Well, instead, in this different equivalent representation, all these dot products in the first layer need to be computed, even if you have to compute to multiply times 0. And then this AND operation is applied in the second part. And so you can see that in terms of number of operations, this tends to be heavier than this. And so then the question is, what happens when we go really deep and we have deep convolutional neural networks in multiple layers? Clearly, they perform a lot of operations. And can we use this intuition to try to minimize the number of computation and therefore increase the efficiency of this new version of tree-ified convolutional neural network, if you want. And here's another way of looking at this problem. So imagine that we have a convolutional neural network, and we represent it this way. Imagine that there are lots of, say, layers before here, and this is the final layers. And imagine that we have trained this convolutional neural network on the standard ImageNet image classification problem. Then what we can do is we can look at the co-activations of neurons in this layer and neurons on this layer. So this and this, purple is high and white is low. So we see that there is a little bit of structure going on there. And if we reorder the rows and columns, i.e. we reorder the neurons on the layer one and layer two, we clearly see this block diagonal, asymmetrical block diagonal structure. And so now we can actually zero out the off-diagonal elements completely, which corresponds to eliminating some of the edges, going from layer V1 to layer V2. And if we continue doing this for successive layers, then we can see that we start to get roots or branches. And so this is another way in which we can understand the sort of relationship between convolutional neural networks and decision tree. This now becomes a branch structure, a tree. So based on all these sort of intuitions, then we decided, let's really try to push these ideas. And first of all, we need to come up with a graphical language that can help us deal with combination of CNN type structures and decision tree type structures. And we definitely cannot use this sort of graphical notation, which is taken from the Krzyzewski paper, for instance, because it's very complex and perhaps too detailed. And so we represent our transformations from one layer to the next using this simpler notation. And this is just a graphical language, nothing particularly interesting about this. And so we have a projection matrix, just a matrix, linear transformation, followed by this squiggle that it just represents a generic nonlinearity. It could be a ReLU, it could be sigmoid or tang or whatever you prefer. So now we can make, we can create really complex and models. So we call this thing a conditional network, just because we needed to invent a new name. But the interesting part about this is that you can really combine together some of the properties of decision trees with some of the properties of convolutional neural networks. So for instance, this part, behaves very much like a tree. You can see that the data going from one layer to the next is not transformed, just like in a decision tree. This is an identity. And there is this red thing, which is nothing but a very small single layer perception that acts as your split function, your decision function, and opens sort of these gates to send the data either here or here or here. This could be a hard gating function or a soft gating function, and so on. Then we can have other transformations. So in this layer here, perhaps we have a gate or a split function, but also the data is transformed through a nonlinear transformation, which is more typical of convolutional networks. And then we can have merging operations, which make this whole thing behave more like a DAG rather than a tree. You can select data, some features from this vector into a smaller vector here. So you can mix and match all these different operations into a more general type of structure. So if you look at, from beginning to end, this sort of yellowish path is very much a convolutional neural network. A structure like this is a more traditional decision tree. In this case, we have a ternary and then binary splits. And the cool thing is that if you choose the right nonlinearity, say a sigmoid or a rectified linear unit, something that is differentiable, then the whole structure continues to be differentiable, and therefore you can train it using gradient descent back propagation. Of course, this is a lot of math. I'm not expecting you to read it all, but just to show that it can be done. So what we've done is we put this idea to the test, and using the ImageNet testbed, we looked at one of the existing convolutional neural network architectures. This is the one from the Oxford group, called VGG11 because it uses 11 layers. And because we believe that imposing on this a tree-like structure can improve the efficiency, rather than the accuracy. Then we decided to start from the structure, looking at the layers which were most computationally expensive. So these are clearly in the convolutional part, and split those into branches, different routes, to divide the computation in different areas. And so we came up with this alternative structure, where you can see this sort of branching architecture. And indeed, when we put it to the test, we see that in this 3D plot, where we have error cost, 10 time cost, test time cost in terms of number of operations, and model size. So for a good architecture, you want to be as close to the origin as possible. So Google Net is an incredibly good architecture. It's not only very accurate, but also very efficient. It was designed by hand and by search in many ways. And our conditional network is a derivation of this network in yellow here, the VGG11, with exactly the same accuracy, but much greater efficiency, both in terms of number of operations and also in terms of reduced number of parameters. I only have 5 minutes, and so rather than talking about more architecture and CNN and stuff like that, I also wanted to give you a flavor of the sort of applications that we're building and we're thinking of, where we use this sort of efficient machine learning in the analysis of medical images. So this is a small demo driven by our collaborators at the University of Washington Medical Center. The radiologists we're working with, they work in ER, and they're interested in trauma cases. You know, people who are admitted into the ER because they have been in a car accident or a bicycle accident, and something is broken. Maybe bones are broken with them, it's not clear. First thing that happens is that the patient goes into a CT scanner, and a sort of large view of their body is captured. And what they do is they typically use the patient's spine as a patient-centric coordinate system to figure out what is broken and how to refer it back to the individual vertebrae. Each of them have got a name. And so what we do in this application is I just load this image. Let's see if I can do it. Yeah, and as the image gets loaded, the computation happens in the background and done. So now we have the knowledge of where the spine is and each individual vertebra, what it is called. We can run a very simple PCA type refinement, which you will see the image wiggle about a little bit. And now that the system knows where the individual vertebrae are and what they're called, we can just very simply navigate to the individual vertebrae to the best view by clicking on the names. And this is actually a very practical application that saves radiologists in the ER department a lot of time. A similar application, again, using random forest and this sort of technology that I explained to you, is this one. This is a magnetic resonance image of a patient's brain. This is from the Cambridgeshire area. This is in collaboration with Adam Brooks. And what we do is we trained one of those models to recognize for each individual voxel in this picture which class it belongs to. So it's a little bit like the Kinect problem, but looking at 3D images, and there are multimodality images. Actually, we have several of these view with different MR parameters. So we can very simply click on run segmentation. The forest model is loaded. It is applied live on the image, and this classification happens. The three different colors indicate the actively proliferating part of the tumor in red, and then the necrotic core, the dead part of the brain, in green, and then the inflammation area, which is mostly healthy but not completely healthy, in yellow. And this is another one of these tools which saves a lot of time and a lot of cost in clinical workflows, such as radiation therapy planning. So I'm going to stop here because I was instructed to do so by a German guy.
Not by myself, but it leaves time for questions. So let's first thank Antonio again, and then
thank you. Ask you. Yes.
For the moment, the tree structure is being imposed on the neural network. You force, if I understand correctly, Do you foresee ways to have some kind of structural learning as well? Mm-hmm. I mean, the background of that question is usually when you start imposing structures on something which does machine learning, automatically it starts getting the results down, up, or results don't stay the same. So do you foresee a way that the neural networks and the tree structure could be learned by some super?
No, we don't do that. There is a lot of previous work where first they train a CNN structure, and then they sparsify it. And you can do it in many different ways. We don't do that. You know, we use the intuition to actually construct a new structure which is not trained at all. It's randomly initialized, and we train it from scratch. So the fact that we train it from scratch makes a big difference to our results and also compared to previous work. Okay. Yes?
I would like to ask, how do you split nodes in the convolutional layers? Because you mentioned how you can do this in linear layers,
So, you know, in the convolution layers, you know, you always have, you know, a representation of the output of the previous layer as a number of features, right? So there are two ways in which you can split the data to left and right branch. One is using an explicit branching operator, like a split function, which takes the entire vector, analyzes it, and says this goes to the left, this goes to the right, and the number of dimensions is exactly the same. And another one is what was used by the original Alex Krizeski paper, where instead, without having any explicit split function, they just say half of the features go to this GPU and half of the features go to the other GPU. We explored both techniques here. And so we talk about both explicit splitting and implicit splitting. It's not a fantastic terminology, but that's all we could come up with.
Okay, if there one last question.
Oh, I know you.
You said you use intuition to design the branching network. Can you give us an insight into what would guide you in that process?
Oh, no, it's not entirely intuition. You know, we looked at the cost of the operations in each layer. And so you can, you know, compute the number of operations that need to be performed in each layer, and inevitably you find that the convolution layers are the most expensive ones. And so that's why we tackled those layers first and, you know, split up those layers. And you can use a similar argument for the number of parameters, because of course, you know, one of the things we're aiming for is not just computational efficiency, but also achieving the highest accuracy as possible with the minimum number of parameters as possible to avoid or minimize problems like overfitting.
Okay, let's thank Antonio.
Thank you very much.
And sorry for the delay. So I would like to talk about neural networks today. And one of the most interesting properties of neural network is that it is over-parameterized, meaning that if you think about the left-hand side, the set of functions you can represent with your neural network, and on the right-hand side, you have all the parameters, the space of parameters, the mapping between the two sets are not one-to-one. So for example, if the activation is rectified linear, then what you can do is, given one node, you can scale down the weights coming into this unit and scale up the weights going out of this unit. And that doesn't change what the function computes. It's exactly the same function, but different weight configuration. So I'm wondering, or I'm thinking in this line, so because of all these ambiguities, so does neural network generalize better all because of these ambiguities or over-parameterization? Or other question is, if we are aware of what kind of ambiguities we have, can we use that to build better optimization algorithms? And in order to answer these questions, there is a more basic question that we'd like to think about, what sort of ambiguities there are. So I talked about the node-wise rescaling ambiguity. Is that all the ambiguities we have, or do we have more than that? So to start with, let's think about this rescaling ambiguity in more detail. So pick one node in the first hidden layer, and assume that every nonlinearity is a rectified linear. So I can do the following transform, that I can divide this incoming weights by the norm. So now the weight coming into this node have unit norm, and I multiply the constant to the weights going up. So this doesn't change the function at all. And I can repeat this process for every node in the first layer. So all the nodes in the first layer have unit norm now. And I can repeat this process for all the nodes in the second layer, and so on. So everything is normalized up to here, except for the last layer. The last layer, you cannot do this because there's nothing going up there. So the scale is meaningful. But you see that you can normalize all the nodes up to the last layer without changing the function at all. So it means that the scale of the weights carry no meaning, except for the last layer. So it doesn't change the function. And in particular, you can write the following thing. So this is a set of functions you can represent with your original parameterization. All the functions you can represent with your original parameterization. You can restrict the norm of the weights coming into each node, except for the last layer, to be 1. And this doesn't change the set of functions you can represent, right? And you can even do something even more crazier. Instead of parameterizing by the original parameter, you can say that I'm going to parameterize with W tilde and divide by the norm of W tilde. So now there is no explicit constraint, but this set of functions is exactly the same as this set of functions. So all three parameterizations are different, but the set of functions you can represent are the same. So this might be a little bit worrisome. So actually, you can test that easily on MNIST dataset. So this is a four-layer network with 1024 units in each layer. And I plotted the norm of each layer along the epochs, right? So you can see that there is one layer going, the norm is going up. And this is, you can see that it's the last layer. So that the norm of the last layer carries some meaning. But except for the last layer, all the layers up to the third layer, the norm is constant. So obviously, because changing the norm does not change the function at all, the optimization algorithm doesn't care about the norm because it doesn't make you classify better or worse. So you can see that only the norm of the last layer is going up, and all the other layers are staying where you initialized the network. It's an interesting observation. Also, you might think that this is special because it's a ReLU network. I also did a simulation with sigmoid. So now the theory doesn't hold exactly. But it seemed that, only the last layer, the norm of the last layer is going up, and the norm of the first three layers are staying almost constant. It is going slightly more, it's changing a bit more than the ReLU network. So the theory does not hold exactly. But a similar trend is here. So in fact, you can show that if there is a direction that you change the parameter, but the function does not change significantly, then you can say that actually show that the inner product of the gradient and the direction is 0. So this is a simple, basically, chain rule in saying that this is a Taylor expansion and there is no first order term, so the dot product of the gradient and this is a Jacobian and the delta must be 0. So that's the reasoning. So basically, gradient, if you do gradient descent, you'll not go in the direction that does not change your function. So that's very reasonable, right? But is that good enough? So now think about the two parameterizations I mentioned in the beginning. So in one parameterization, you update your parameter in the direction of your gradient. Fine. And there's another parameterization. Basically, you divide your weight with the norm of the weight. And if you only do that for layers up to, except for the last layer, the set of functions you can present are exactly the same. So you don't have to worry about it. But now the optimization step looks different. This is the update step in this new parameterization. You can always come back from this parameterization to the original parameterization. And you can ask the question, if I move one step in this parameterization and do the same mapping going back to the original parameterization, you can do the same calculation in Taylor expansion. And you see that this is not the same as if you moved in the original parameterization. Moving in the original parameterization is not the same as moving in the other parameterization is coming back to the original parameterization. So gradient descent is inherently parameterization sensitive. So in this respect, I think there are two philosophies. So one is that because all these things, or most of the things we do, are parameterization sensitive, you can say, OK, let's pick a parameterization that works the best. So this relates to what I'm going to talk about called batch normalization method that was proposed by some people from Google last year. And also, if you analyze Bayesian neural networks, there's a very nice book from Sumio Watanabe. And this is the kind of philosophy behind it. So it's so it tries to justify why neural networks is good in some sense. The other part, other philosophy is that, oh no, we don't want to be sensitive to this kind of arbitrariness in the way we define the model. We should only care about the set of functions we can represent with the model, right? Then we want to be invariant to the parameterization. So there are different methods, for example, natural gradient or Bayesian neural networks if you use Jeffrey Spire. And there's a method called pathicity I'd like to comment in this talk that is built in this philosophy. So let's look at the two things. So how much time? OK, good, good. So let's look at this batch normalization first, which is built on the let's find a good parameterization philosophy. Okay. So the idea of batch normalization is that you want to normalize the pre-activation before applying nonlinearity, I mean, so that it has mean zero and unit variance. The way you realize this is that you have to have a separate unlabeled examples, which you use to calculate the mean and standard deviation or variance. And then you use that to subtract the mean and divide by standard deviation. So if the statistics of the training minibatch and the normalization minibatch are the same, then this transformation written here will guarantee that it'll have mean zero and variance one. And this seems to work very well in practice. And I'm going to look at this as a reparameterization. So you can easily do this transformation that basically what you're doing is subtracting the mean, and after that, multiplying this weight, which is defined as original weight, divided by something that looks like the standard deviation. So if you compare this to what I talked earlier, you can see now that this is something that depends on data, because you have this covariance matrix that is calculated from the separate unlabeled minibatch. So now this is a reparameterization of the weights that you know, you're not restricting the set of functions you can present because of all the scaling ambiguities you have in the network. But this parameterization is a data-dependent reparameterization. So because this is a reparameterization, so you can call this a new parameter. And this is not a parameterization invariant, because you at the end, what you're doing is a gradient descent on this new parameterization. But it works well, very well in practice in terms of both generalization and also optimization. So this is interesting. So there's another method that I would like to comment about. This is based built on the other philosophy that if there is such ambiguity or invariances, I want to be invariant to such thing that the optimization algorithm should behave the same way in one parameterization and the other parameterization. So this is an algorithm that is derived as steepest descent with some specifically defined norm on the network. But if you look at it, it is just a element-wise rescaling. So this is a gradient, original gradient. And you scale this with this constant kappa e. And what this does is that assume that you want to update this weight coming from this node to this node. So this is defined as a sum over many passes that goes through this edge. So this is one path. This is another path. This is another path. And you can enumerate all the passes. And what you're calculating here is the product of the square of the weights along this path, except for the weight you want to update. So this seems like a very strange thing. And also, it looks like you have to enumerate all paths. That's going to be computationally hard. But actually, this thing can be computed very efficiently by just one forward and one backward propagation. So computationally, it is very cheap. And it's just the element-wise rescaling of the update. And what it does is that actually, it is invariant to this kind of node-wise rescaling I talked about. So assume that the incoming weights are scaled down with alpha, and the outgoing weights are scaled up with alpha, then what happens is that this constant is going to be smaller for the outgoing weights, and this constant is going to be alpha squared times bigger for the incoming weights, and this cancels with the scaling of the gradient itself. And it turns out that the update of the outgoing weights are proportional to the scaling factor alpha, and the update of the incoming weights are inversely proportional to the scaling parameter. So this will behave just the same way. If you randomly rescale all the nodes in the network, it'll just behave the same way as you would in the original parameterization. So finally, I think I have 3 minutes or so. Okay. So finally, the question is, okay, so this algorithm is invariant to node-wise rescaling, and it works well. So is that good enough? Because there might be other kind of ambiguities or invariances in the network that we have to be aware of. So let's do a small simulation. So it's a three-layer network with 64 inputs and 32, 33, and 10 outputs, just like a small version of MNIST. So how many ambiguities do we have? Right? The question is, how many ambiguities do we have? So there's a theorem. Very informally stated, the number of parameters in this network is the sum of the degrees of freedom. So this is the active part. Degrees of freedom is the part that if you change the parameter, it'll respond in a sense that it'll change the output of the function. And the number of ambiguities is the part, the subspace, you can imagine, that you change the parameter in this direction, but doesn't affect the function at all. So there's a kind of rank nullity theorem here that basically you can decompose the subspace into the space that you span with your parameter change in your parameter and the direction that doesn't change the parameter, the function you represent at all. So my guess was that if all we have to worry about is node-wise rescaling, because we have 64 internal nodes, so for each of them, I can do this trick, right? I can, for each internal node, I can scale down and scale up and scale down and scale up. So I have at least 64 ambiguities here for each internal node. So the total number of parameters is 3466. And if node-wise rescaling was the only kind of ambiguities we have here, then the degrees of freedom should be 3402. So, right? So, is that true or not? So, I did a simulation last night, and it turns out that it is not quite there. So, what I plotted here was I calculated the Jacobian of the network, and I plotted the rank of the Jacobian along the number of samples. So, obviously, the more samples you have, the span will increase. So, the rank is a monotone increasing function. And I tested up to around 4,000 samples. And it seemed that the rank kind of asymptote around here. It is slightly increasing, so you cannot say anything concrete from this. But there seems to be some strange gap between what I imagined from just counting the number of internal nodes to the rank I calculated from this example. So so this is the last slide. I just want to discuss the limitation of the approach I just did. So the rank of the Jacobian depends on two things. So it depends on the parameter you pick, and also it depends on the input distribution. So the parameter dependency is critical, because you can definitely choose degenerate parameter configuration. You can set some of the weights to zero and pretend that there is no, you know, units there, right? But the question is there a typical behavior, right? If you are in the typical operating regime of the network, is there a number that you can say roughly, okay, this structure, so the degrees of freedom should be that? And this kind of typical behavior, there's a typo here, may arise if you consider a large network. That was like 64 and 32. So that's not a large network at all. But if we consider large network, maybe this kind of typical behavior may arise. The other dependency is the input distribution. So it definitely depends how rich your input distribution is. And of course, you can always replace that with random numbers and say that my network fit is random numbers. But the question is how far that is from the reality. When we train something on MNIST or when we train something on ImageNet, that is different from a random Gaussian distribution. So there is an interesting question here that how can we separate the property of the network, that is the degree of freedom I just calculated, from the property of the input distribution. Thank you very much.
Two questions. So one of them is some of the symmetries in the network come from permutations, which is hard to incorporate into this framework because those are discrete symmetries.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Some might come from rotations in the weight space, right? So you could do rescaling, but you could also, I mean, ReLUs that are not rotation invariant, but you know the linear part certainly is. And some of this has to do with the fact that if a ReLU is just zero, when it's zero, actually you don't care at all about the parameters.
Right.
So in that regime, there's...
Yes.
So
regarding rotation, that is definitely an interesting aspect for the input layer, because rotation in the input layer is free, right? You can rotate or transform your input data in many different ways, and typically you want to be invariant to that kind of transformation. So I would say you want to be invariant to inserting a linear layer under your bottom layer. That should be a natural requirement for a network. And that is definitely not accounted for in this rescaling invariance.
And sorry, just a quick follow-up. You suggested kind of two ways of getting around it. One by basically doing something like path SGD, and one by doing batch normalization.
Yeah.
So what would you suggest? What do you prefer?
So you know, more principled view of this would be to be invariant, right? That seems to be you know, more principled. You know, if you think of the set of functions, that's all you care about. You don't want to worry about the parameterization. Because there are so many tricks you can play if you make yourself parameterization dependent. But obviously, people have come up with all these tricks, and they work well in practice. So it's hard to ignore those progress. And it's not only about optimization, but it's also about generalization. That makes it even more curious.
Any more questions? If not, then let's thank Piotr again.
Talking about the factors behind hiring decisions
based on online social network profiles.
Right. So I have the privilege of being the last thing standing between you and lunch. So I'll try and be quick, but you know, interrupt with questions anytime. So the topic is hiring in social networks. So, you know, clearly social networks are very, very influential, but when we think about this, we tend to focus on friendships and our relations with friends. But they carry a lot of weight in the real world. There are some mistakes that you can make in social networks that will cost you dearly, like this example here, right? So obviously they carry traction in the real world, and they've been a revolution not just in how we communicate with our friends, but in other circles as well. So Jovite had a very, very interesting survey. They do this every year, and that's about recruiters and social media. So basically what they did is they asked lots of recruiters lots of questions about how they use social media in hiring decisions. So first, you know, they ask, which social networks do you use for recruiting? And you know, big surprise, LinkedIn is one of the top choices. But then there are some other choices that might surprise some of you. Like Facebook is very, very commonly used, and maybe Twitter and Google Plus and some of the other ones. And you might ask yourself, well, why are they looking in these networks, right? LinkedIn was designed for hiring. Why do they need these other ones? And then, you know, from the survey, they've learned that 93% of the recruiters will review these social networks before reaching a decision. So it's not just a fringe phenomena. It's not just, you know, that very, very few recruiters use this. All of them use this. And then, so they broke down the answers, what do they look for in a candidate based on the social network. So clearly, you know, they use LinkedIn for professional experience, but they also look for evidence for that, you know, some of them in Facebook. And then they look at stuff like how long you've been with your current employer, they look at your industry-related posts, they look at things like mutual connections, do we know someone that we can ask about you, so they're quite sneaky. They look for specific hard skills, again, less in Facebook and more in LinkedIn. But then, you know, comes up this nasty thing of cultural fit. How well will you fit within the organization? So there, you know, Facebook suddenly comes into play much more. And then sometimes they even look for examples of some of your work in some fields. So, okay, clearly very influential. So, you know, some of you might remember what I call the old world. Like back then in the day, if you wanted to apply for a position, you send your CV and an application letter. And then the hiring manager or someone in the hiring firm would look at this and decide whether they want to bring you for a face-to-face job interview. And then if they liked you, they would think about this a little bit and make you an offer or not. In the new world, we have a slightly different structure. So, you know, they use both your CV and maybe your application letter, but they also investigate you online social networks, for example, like LinkedIn accounts, and maybe headhunters are involved in the process. And the screening is a bit more tiered, right? So suddenly, you know, there are multiple steps. You don't just send your CV. You send your CV, they take a look. If they like it, then they move on and they investigate you online. If they like what they see, then they bring you over, and then maybe they look at your online websites a bit more in depth. And one nasty trick that sort of snuck into this world is asking applicants to hand over their passwords. So sure, you know, some of these, you might be aware that some of these networks have some privacy settings, so not everything you put online is available for all the world to see. You can restrict the access. So sure, you can restrict the access, but then the hiring managers or someone in the HR department might come to you and say, look, you know, we understand that you've got a lot of nice content there. We want to see it before we decide whether to hire you or not. You know, send us your password. And, you know, okay, some of you are shocked, but, you know, if you're desperate for a job, you might give them the password. There are also lighter tricks for doing this. So they might come to you and say, look, you know, come on over, sit with our HR professional, type in your password. We don't need to know your password. We just want to look at the content. We'll scrum through your profile. You can be there to make sure we don't send emails on your behalf or anything like that. We're not going to be mean. This is a rather new phenomenon. Some of you might be surprised, but this has happened. If you look for general media reports about this, this is becoming more and more frequent. And in fact, some universities have also done things like this, and that reached the general media when they look for potential people to come for the university. So it's not just, you know, hiring per se. Fine, okay, what are they looking for, right? So what Jovite uses is self-reports. They ask recruiters, well, what do you perceive as important? So, you know, a lot of the recruiters, 55%, have reconsidered a candidate based on their social profile. Most of these were negative reconsiderations. So, you know, the social network did not help the candidate in most of these cases. what could you do wrong in social media, you might ask yourself. So here is what the recruiter said. You know, you can curse, you can have lousy spelling and grammar, you can reference illegal drugs, you can have sexual posts. Sometimes you can have something that relates to volunteering and donations. That's actually on the positive side. Do you see this? Yes, right here. Political affiliation does come into play. Most of them said, I'm neutral about this. I'm not sure, but maybe. Alcohol is probably on the bad side, guns, and so on. Fine. So this is what they perceive as things not to do in social circles, in social media. But then there's the question, okay, what actually influences their opinions in practice? That's the reason for studying this through an experiment, which I call the Facebook job interview experiment. So it's rather simple. I sourced a bunch of Mechanical Turkers, people on Amazon's Mechanical Turk, roughly 500 raters, to examine a bunch of volunteered Facebook profiles, roughly 250 profiles in total. So each of the raters would examine one or more of these volunteered profiles, and they would write a report about these profiles. I'll tell you what's in the report in a minute. But basically, the task is, I want to hire this guy for a job. Please tell me what you think about this guy, and they produce the report. So there's a nice little data set with 850 such reports. Simple enough. So I chose to focus on some specific components and some specific criteria that relate to hiring. So in terms of profile components, so this was carried through Facebook. So the profile picture, then all the other photos that people upload, the items that they like or the groups they're members of, their friends, and the textual posts themselves. So you know, these are profile components. There are also some specific criteria that you might consider with regard to hiring, like in that job-wide survey. So skills, experience, and intelligence, that's not a big surprise. Attitude and personality. You can consider physical appearance. Some of you might say, well, how is that relevant to jobs? But you know, that's one possible criteria. There is offensive content and content relating to vices. So you know, all that stuff like offensive language, drug and alcohol, and so on. Then your interests, activities, and hobbies. And then a lot of demographic traits like you know, your age, family status, religious or political beliefs, or other demographic traits. Some of these might not be considered legal to ask during a job interview. Right, so I wanted to make the separation between perceived importance and actual importance. So all the things in the data set contained is basically, here is the rater, here is their target, the person that they've looked in their profile, and then perceptions regarding these various issues about the quality of the candidate. You can ask people to give you perceived importance, like in the job-wide survey, which basically says how important do you think this factor would be in your hiring decisions before you've even looked at a single profile. And then the way I did it is using a certain amount of points that they had to allocate across the profile components or across the criteria. So for example, here are 100 points. Tell me how important each of these factors are, like your experience and your intelligence, or like your physical attractiveness, and so on. But allocate 100 points across these. They have to sum up to 100. And then to measure actual importance, there were lots of questions like, how well does this specific candidate do in your eyes regarding a specific criterion? So you know, focus on a single thing regarding this candidate. Only judge their experience and intelligence, ignoring all the other factors as best you can. And tell me how well this candidate does in that specific criterion. And then you can apply all kinds of factor importance measure, which try and measure how critical this factor is in the overall perception. So some techniques borrowed from econometrics. So let's go into this in a bit more depth. So the only tool used in this analysis is linear regression. So you know the simplest form you can think of. So we have these focused ratings. Focused ratings relate to a specific criterion or a profile component, and they are the score of a candidate regarding only this trait. So the people that gave these focused ratings tried to ignore all the other factors. So I ask you a single job suitability criterion, or I ask them to give a rating regarding a single part of the profile component. Tell me what you think of this candidate based only on the profile picture, if you can. And then I apply some linear regression models that go from either the focused ratings of job suitability criteria to the overall score that they gave to the candidate, or going from the focused rating of profile parts into the overall score. So I have both the total score that they gave the candidate and these broken down scores that focus on specific things. And I apply a linear regression model. So you know, the goal of this trick is not to figure out who the best candidates are. Rather, it's to figure out which are the important factors when people actually make these hiring decisions. So this requires a tool for computing factor importance measure in regression models. And if you look in the literature, there are plenty of these floating about. I chose three of them. So one is partial correlation. So these are correlations between a factor and the target, trying to control for all the other factors you want to ignore. There are normalized regression coefficients. So basically, you first apply a transformation to z-scores on every single input in the system. You try to normalize them, fit a normal distribution to them. And then you can just use the weights that you get in the end of the regression as an importance measure. Or you can look at the change in the coefficient of multiple determinations. So basically, you look at your accuracy, measured as r squared, when you take all the factors together, including a specific factor whose importance you're trying to measure, and when you apply the same regression when you exclude that specific factor. So the difference in accuracy between the two allows you to figure out how important that factor is. So if you start looking at the profile components, so what I have here in blue is the perceived importance of various profile components, and in orange, the actual importance. So perceived importance is, you know, how important it is using this 100 points allocated, how important they think a factor is, and the actual importance is how much this influenced them in practice based on the data available. So as you can see, all of these factors come into play, you know, at varying degrees, but even the smallest one, which is the friends list, is about 12%, 13% of the overall opinion regarding candidates. So, you know, all of these come into play. But there seems to be a decent correlation between the perceived importance and actual importance. So, you know, whatever people thought would influence their opinions actually did influence their opinions in practice. One interesting bit is that the profile picture actually has a much higher importance than its perceived importance. So in fact, the profile picture was incredibly influential on people's opinions when it came to hiring. Yes, Ubin?
Do they see a profile in the same way that one would normally see a profile, with the profile picture first and then all the other information?
Well, almost. So yes, they viewed the profiles using the, you know, the standard Facebook interface. So basically, I provided a link, and they followed the link. Except whoever volunteered their profile had to remove all the privacy settings. So this is a simulation of what happens if you were to remove all your privacy protection or hand over your password. And yes, you know, the picture does appear there visually. It's very, very important. But again, you know, the task was try and ignore the profile picture when you focus on the other stuff.
But it also appears kind of first, usually, right?
Yes. Yes, yes. So first impressions apparently do count. But then, you know, so, you know, unsurprisingly, the posts that people have are also very, very important. The photos are still important, maybe in actual less than perceived importance, but still carry a lot of weight. And even your friends carry some weight. Yes?
You just explained on the friend list. Do they get, I mean, just having a list of friends, doing anything about them is kind of meaningless.
So they have access to Facebook, right? So I tell them, you know, go in and investigate. They do whatever they want, right? If they're very diligent, if they're overly diligent, they start looking at your friends and evaluating your friends. I did not ask them what exactly they did, but it does carry some weight. Right. If we look at the specific criteria that I talked about earlier, then I think the picture becomes even more involved. So again, you know, one thing that stands out is all of these actually come into play. All the possible factors I could imagine actually carry some weight regarding job hiring through social networks, including, you know, the demographic traits of an individual. Unsurprisingly, maybe, you know, your skills and intelligence is the thing that counts most. But even that factor is roughly a quarter of the total importance. And then people maybe overestimated the importance of, you know, offensive content or all those mistakes that were on the job-wide survey. But it, you know, it still carries about 15% weight. And then your attitude and personality are actually quite important in this method for hiring. Physical appearance does carry some weight, and obviously your interests, activities, and the demographic traits. So, you know, all of these, it's a very, very big mix. And you know, if you were asking people what they thought would be important based on your CV, I would expect skills and intelligence to carry a much larger proportion. So there is a difference between this new world and the old world. So I want to make some conclusions and then leave some time for questions. So obviously, social network-based screening covers lots and lots of factors, and more factors than CVs. So in fact, I actually did the same sort of experiment with CVs rather than Facebook. So people volunteered their CVs, and those CVs were evaluated by other people. And unsurprisingly, it's pretty hard to judge someone's physical appearance from a CV. I mean, you can try, but most people don't put pictures in their CVs. They certainly wouldn't provide a lot of information about their demographics. They wouldn't tell you their political opinion in the CV. So obviously, all these factors only carry far less weight. There is still a leakage, at least, of personalities through CVs. So people do try and figure out something about cultural fit just based on CVs, but again, to a far lower extent than through social networks. So, this is certainly a new form of hiring or a new data source because it looks at other factors. This is certainly shallower than a face-to-face job interview, right? If someone forms an opinion about you in a face-to-face job interview, you have the opportunity of defending yourself or, actually conversing with the other side. Profiles tend not to talk back. This is a bit shallower. But it includes additional factors. So, it's clear why employers are using this. It's a very, very cheap and somewhat effective way of getting additional information and additional insights about people than they would just using their CVs. Obviously, there are lots of legal and ethical considerations that we can talk about here. Some people, when I talk about this, people ask me, is this even legal? Well, legal depends on where. So for instance, in a couple of states in the U.S., it's not allowed to ask someone to hand over their password for a social network for hiring. But this is the level of restriction here. Sure, you're allowed to use social networks, but you can't ask candidates to hand over passwords, and even that is only in a few states in the U.S. In other states, it's completely allowed. If you ask users to do this, this is likely to be perceived as invading the user's privacy, but it doesn't mean you will never get these passwords or you will never get this information. Clearly, LinkedIn is fairly easy. It's fair play. People put their LinkedIn profile out there, a lot for hiring possibilities. So I think that's more of a fair play, but I'm talking about the other networks. There are issues regarding protected groups. So, you're not allowed to discriminate against people for going to AA, Alcoholic Anonymous, in the U.S. So you're not even allowed to ask the question, do you go to AA and then not hire a person? You could be sued. But obviously, this kind of information might float about. If there's a picture of you drinking something, people might assume things. There is also the issue of, does the internet forget? So, whatever you put out there online, even when you're very, very young, let's say, 18 years old, stays there for a long period of time or maybe even forever, depending on who you ask. And that means this can have repercussions much later in life. So obviously, people would become more sensitive to this because this carries a lot of weight for a long period of time. I wanted to point out some very, very important limitations of this work. So first of all, as you probably noticed, this is an observational study rather than a controlled experiment, right? It's not that I took people's Facebook pages and changed just one thing and then let other people evaluate that. Like, one possibility is just to take the same profile, change the profile picture from a very attractive person to a less attractive person, and then see what happens to all the scores. That's not what I did. This is an observational study, and that comes with a lot of limitations. It's hard to infer causal relations from this sort of study. And another important consideration is, I've used Amazon's Mechanical Turk. So these people in Amazon's Mechanical Turk are not big shot hiring managers. Most of them are not big shot hiring managers in firms or HR professionals with lots of years of experience and knowledge of the law. This represents what some people might do. I did ask I asked all of them, have you ever been involved in hiring decisions as a hiring manager? 20% said yes, but in the internet, anyone can say whatever they want, including dogs could say they were previously hiring managers. So, take that with a grain of salt. That's all I had to say. Thank you.
We have time for questions.
Yeah.
Was your study done for particular type of roles, like technical, non-technical?
So I did not provide any information about what the person was interviewed for. And actually, I got very few. But you know, out of the 500 or so raters, three wrote back, look, buddy, you better tell me what you're hiring this person for, because otherwise it's going to be hard for me to evaluate. But only three of them did. The rest just did the task. And they said, you know, if you're going to ask whether this guy is good for laying bricks, that literally that's what they said. If you want to hire this guy to lay bricks, maybe not the best choice. But other than that, I don't see why you should care about their physical appearance or, you know, physical skills. 3 out of 500. Yeah.
Is there, like you talked about, you only in two U.S. states, it's not...
Four. Last time I checked.
Is it not legal to ask for passwords? I mean, that's pretty shocking.
It doesn't mean it's allowed in the other state. It means it's gray territory, right?
Yeah.
It's,
what about under EU law? Is it more...
I don't know. The straight answer is I don't know. I suspect the EU is harsher on this sort of stuff, I would hope. But I don't know.
Regarding missing information, so if someone doesn't have a social media profile, for example?
That's a very good question. So you know, given this information, there are now lots of strategies for handling this. You know, some people might say, okay, fine, I'll just erase my Facebook account. I don't need that anymore. I don't want that with all these implications. But you know, what does that mean? What signal does it send to the employer? This guy doesn't have a Facebook account. I mean, is this guy even alive in this century? I don't know. I think this deserves an experiment on its own. I don't have a good answer for you. There are lots of other things that you can do, right? You can be very cautious about what you post online, but that makes the platform a bit less enjoyable for you. You can deliberately put content out there for people to see, like you know a lot of people do in LinkedIn. It's not so clear. Yes?
Two things. First of all, you don't need to ask for the password, right? I mean, to what extent do people just send a friend request?
So, okay, I didn't talk about that strategy from an HR professional. Yes, that's another option. Or they can ask some of your friends. You know, they're looking for these mutual connections so they can ask about you. There are lots of ways of circumventing these privacy settings. I don't know which ones are more used in practice and which one are more successful. I suspect the JobVite survey would have something to say about this, but you know, need to check.
And then the other thing, I don't know, you may know the numbers from previous work. Don't most teens have two Facebook profiles?
I don't know, but that's certainly a strategy. So first of all, teens under certain ages shouldn't have Facebook profiles, but we know some of them might have. Yes, you know, you can have two Facebook profiles, one for work and one for play. Again, you know, they might still find the other one, not so clear. Yes.
So I'm not sure if you give your password will show that you're a good candidate, because it means that you don't have other options. Actually, if I want to hire someone, if he gives me his password, I won't hire him.
Yeah, I mean, are you desperate, right? It's like asking, are you desperate for this job?
He doesn't have other options. He has to work for only me.
Yeah, well, first of all, I have to say, you know, it's not that all employers or even most of the employers that look at social network profiles ask for passwords. I think this is still a fringe. I hope this is still a fringe phenomena. Again, you know, I'm not sure how many of them even bother to look beyond just LinkedIn. But it seems like from the JobVite survey, quite a few of them at least mention looking in Facebook. And again, you know, Facebook, if you don't use privacy settings, they see a lot. If everybody uses privacy settings, then they have no business looking in Facebook because there's nothing in there anyway. But they bother to look in Facebook. So that means there is some information there in most of the cases.
I have a question. Did your data tell us anything about the correlation between, I don't know, the appearance to have a vice versus actual performance? Because some privacy people say we shouldn't worry about some youthful indiscretion when you're 18 that got onto Facebook, because a rational company would just ignore that, because you know we're all high performers in this room, and I bet a high proportion of us did something you regret when we were 18. And you know, if it had been this century, it would have been on Facebook.
Yeah, so I mean, I had no information about the people volunteering, the profiles. I did not ask them, you know, are you well appreciated in your job? Did you do anything crazy when you were young? I don't have that information. I think you can certainly at least rely on self-reports to try and get that information. So you can say, you know, in your opinion, are you successful in your career? Or you can ask them how much money they earn. That you know, try and getting all kinds of proxies. But not in this study, no.
So maybe one final question?
The perceived importance of the criteria. So
okay.
If I am trying to be a good HR hire, then I should just put all my perceived importance on the ability, right?
No, there I disagree. So I think it should be a dominant one. But you know, I think cultural fit does come into play, right? I think personality and attitude are still important. For example, I think you shouldn't place lots of points on physical appearance, and they didn't place a lot of points on physical appearance, for example. For most jobs, not modeling, for example. But it's not to say that none of the other factors are important. Actually, I think, you know, honestly, maybe some demographics factors are important for some very, very specific jobs. But, you know, first of all, these are not the kind of questions you would ask in a face-to-face job interview, unless you really want to scare candidates off. But you can certainly get that information from social networks. So there, I think it's an interesting interplay. But yeah, a good choice would be 90 points on experience and intelligence and that sort of thing, and few on the rest.
Much more on the ability.
That's okay. The data, right?
So let's thank Yoram again.
Thank you.